I came across one of the reports of the Planning Commission in which a recommendation was made that the power tariff for the operation of sewage treatment plants should be charged at domestic rates. As of now, to the best of my knowledge, the sewage treatment plants and water treatment plants are treated as commercial entities, and tariff is charged by the electricity providing utilities at commercial rates. I wish if the National Ganga River Mission could take up this issue to have a uniform practice that all sewage treatment plants are provided power at domestic rates, then perhaps the cost of O&M will be drastically reduced, and that will allow the utilities to run the plants after the operational concessionary agreement, which is contemplated for 5 years as per the NGRBA guidelines. And thereafter, the utilities are supposed to maintain the treatment plants of their own. And in that case, the question of tariff comes in, otherwise also right now. And therefore, this issue, I request Professor Tare to kindly keep in mind and think of incorporating in the subsequent manuals. Thank you.
With that, we'll request Dr. Tare to give some comments on the subject.
I think this concept of zero liquid discharge has to be understood properly. Where are we recommending, what are we recommending, and why are we recommending? First thing, we are recommending this only for class 1 towns having population more than 100,000, where construction of sewage treatment plants is unavoidable. Okay, this has to be understood. Where we are not having treatment plant, it's a different scenario. Now, if we want to have a sewage treatment plant, our past experience is that they do not work. Why they do not work? And so on and so forth. So, this proposition is essentially to make sure that whatever we invest in the sewage treatment plant, we get returns on that. This point has to be understood very well, that we just do not want to make investment for the sake of investment, make a sewage treatment plant, show that we are following the norms, and then that treated water goes into a dirty nala. And so we have all the excuses not to run and operate that treatment plant. This has to be understood. So what we are saying is, any sewage treatment plant that is constructed in class 1 towns should necessarily go for reuse and recycle rather than disposing that water, that treated water, into dirty nala or dirty yamuna or whatever, so that the operators do not have the excuse for not operating it. This is first point. Second point that we are proposing, why? Because if you want to make this sewage treatment plant sustainable, how long we can depend on the central support or the state support? We have to at some point of time get out of this. Right, so this is why we are saying, unless until we recover the value, and 99.9% is water in sewage. So if you do not value that, if you do not reuse and recycle that and putting it into the river, right, then you will never be able to recover the cost of that. Never be able to recover the cost, and it will be only an investment and cash flow model. And this is what we have seen in Ganga Action Plan, this is what we have seen in Yamuna Action Plan 1-2, that we essentially look for this much budget is available with the central government or state government or this program or that program. Immediately we make proposals for this capacity or whatever, and then we keep crying for operation and maintenance. So I think we have to get out of this. This is why. So when we say zero liquid discharge, yes, I understand, appreciate the savings, septic tank issues that has to be tackled. We are not talking about that. This is very, it is also important that yes, we talk about in an integrated way, okay, but yes, we can think in an integrated way, but when it comes to working, right, I always talk about entire body, but if one part is not working, I isolate that and work on that, right? So this is what is our approach. See, right now we are looking at, we are putting in big investment in sewage treatment plants in class 1 towns. Our only intention is, how do you make sure that that investment, we get returns on that? This is the main point, and that's why we are talking about, if you allow the standards that yes, once a sewage treatment plant in an town, class 1 town is constructed, that treated water will not go into the drain, it will be reused. And okay, now that reuse could be whatever, in the industry or non-domestic use, or even put it in a pond, right? If you put it in a pond, that also I can call it, where it is absolutely not possible to reuse. The other advantage of going for this kind of thing is, if you want to go for reuse and recycle, the decentralization concept will automatically come in. Because why do we have to make big treatment plants, firstly big sewers, take it to the end of the city or wherever, and then again treated water, bring it back? You have to necessarily create n number of small sewage treatment plants, and where you can find the demand right there. So you reduce on your sewer cost, you also reduce on the conveyance cost, and you okay. And then once this is there, then we can have a business model on that. Because the moment you have a discharge proposition, it is impossible to have a business proposition on that. You cannot think of a public-private partnership. PPP will never work unless until we talk about reuse and recycle. Okay, so that is where this zero liquid, we are not saying complete blanket, this no one can ever discharge into the river, right? We are saying let's start from here, that whatever treatment plants that we construct in class 1 towns, right, they should be on this basis, that the treated water will not go into the river, will be utilized somewhere or the other. Right? This is the concept, and I think we should put it in proper perspective. That.
Thanks, Dr. Tare, because I think that clarified many of the questions that came up. So, since we're lacking time, but we'll go down to the question answer sessions. So, do we have some mics?
Hello. My name is Pranab Majumdar. I'm from Chennai. I liked Mr. Venkatramana's model, and I would request the chair as well as the panelists there, should be regulation as well as there should be some incentive to the industry for the use of recycle and reuse, that also when the private investor will come, the cost of recycled water will go down. Thank you.
So the question is it possible to mandate industry to use recycled water?
Well, I mean, maybe existing thing, but this is what we want to move towards, right? And this is why we are talking about bringing in new legislations, new laws. Yes, existing possibility, the laws may not permit the way our sewage treatment, these state pollution control boards work may not be possible. But I think we need to look at a different. In fact, the fact that we have been asked to prepare a Ganga River Basin Management Plan is also to look at this. And hopefully, once we are in a position to implement somewhere, and it will be, taken, it replicated in other basins or whatever. And Ganga Basin particularly, we are finding it more difficult, because somehow people feel there is plenty of water available in the Ganga Basin. Right? Why it is happening in Chennai? Why we have success stories in Chennai or other places? Because these are water scarce areas. Right? And the price of water, I mean, it comes on its own. It's market driven. Right? Because the cost of the water that the municipal water you get is much more than the treated sewage. In fact, this is the pricing policy that we would like to have. Once you have a pricing policy, the cost of the treated water is less than the cost of the fresh water. And I think for the sake of rivers, because otherwise who pays the cost of the dirtying the river and the groundwater getting polluted? Because so the whole idea of this is internalizing the environmental damages. Right? So the very concept behind all this is, right now what we have is everything is externalized, and when it is externalized, nobody is responsible. So through this concept, what we are trying to do is the environmental damages or damage to the river water, damage to the groundwater is internalized in our own this thing. Okay, and we realize the cost, and now then question of who is to be priced, who is to be charged, that's a different thing. This is where we said it has to be equitable. Those who cannot afford to pay, we don't charge them. Those who can afford, those who are making business, they are charged for it. So all this has to be included in it. Only then it will work.
Thank you. Next question, please.
I just
sure.
Basically, when Mr. Tare was telling, there is a business sense when we started off, but there is also the other thing, what he was talking about as a strict part, that is also slowly moving in. Like there's a pollution control board, when you talk about my effluent earlier, there is no control. As long as I state the minimum national standards, there is no issue, I can let it out. Today, that has almost come to 10% of the level. If I am processing so much of crude, and this is my effluent, and probably only a part of it, maybe 10 to 15%, you can allow to, with the allowable norms. So that is also taking shape. So both the sides are happening. It's not just the business alone.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hello.
Next question, please.
My name is Prathamesh Barar from Organica Water. Three questions that I had. One is that, as Mr. Venkatamana said, there is a necessity which drove them to recycle the water. But is there any legislation contemplated to force these towns and cities who are coming up, who have to set up these plants, to get into this concept of recycling of water? Is that on the agenda of this forum? The second is that, in terms of the financing model, we talk of, you know, recycling and, by private partners, but what is the kind of financial model that is being evolved, which will make them comfortable that if they do this, they would eventually get paid if it is to be, say, discharged in ponds? Because recycling to industry would also happen only if the industry is denied water. Today, if industry is getting water from the local bodies, there is no incentive for them to buy water from a company who is producing recycled water, and therefore this model will not work in that situation. And the third factor is the capacity building of the ULPs, because my observation is that if you look at the local urban bodies, 95% of the time the team is working to crisis manage the water supply demand of the city rather than doing anything else. So how do we ensure that they are sufficiently geared up and trained to handle this kind of new thought or new idea which is coming up here?
I think this, to some extent, we will probably discuss in the next session on PPP, how this will work. And obviously, it has to be supported by the legislation or laws or regulations, okay? And in this case, the implementation of regulation is very simple, and anybody can look at it. Because moment you have a discharge, nobody knows how much BOD or COD it has to go to the laboratory and testing. But anybody, any individual, civil society organization or anybody can definitely look at whether the discharge is going or not going, right? And it is so easily implementable, okay? And then but obviously we'll have to work on the existing policies probably, or the regulations. This is what we are struggling. First, we are struggling that we are bringing down the standards. Okay, we are already MOUD we are working with. So we have said that the effluent discharge standard should be less than 10 BOD, less than 10 SS, nitrate should be less than this, ammonical and TKN should be less than this, phosphorus should be less than this. I think the moment we go for this, this is an implementation, right? And the moment we go for this, I think it's not a very good idea when you treat water to that level, not reuse and recycle. People will automatically find that reuse and recycle is a much better proposition than throwing that water back into the river. Okay, this is the kind of concept that we are. Why we want to? Second thing that we are looking at is, we always look at, okay, if I don't want to discharge, I can use it for irrigation. I think people are missing this point. The water quality requirement for irrigation are much more stringent than what you require for discharging into the river. Okay, because moment you try to put it into the irrigation, you have to worry about the salt. And he just mentioned this, because removal of salt is very, very difficult. So right now we are not talking about the salt, and moment you put in this. So irrigation requirements are far more stringent, and there are other things. So you just cannot say that I will not use and put it for the irrigation. That's not really true. Using for irrigation is not a very easy option. Right now we are sitting and talking about Ganga. Sometime we will also talk about what is happening to our agricultural fields, what is happening to our production. Okay, all those issues are also equal. The second thing, and why we have to put this discharge standard so low, is our target is coliforms in the rivers, right? And for coliforms, we have to necessarily do disinfection. Now, there is no disinfection method which works very well if you do not have TSS less than this, you do not have